Hello, and welcome to today's Islandora webinar. Before we get started today, I would ask that everyone ensures that their microphone is muted so that we can reduce the amount of background noise. This month, we are pleased to showcase the Chinese University of Hong Kong Chinese Digital Collections. The webinar today will feature a presentation and a Q&A session with Louisa Lam, Head of Research Support and Digital Initiatives, and Jeff Liu, Digital Service Librarian at the CUHK Library. I want to let you all know that we are going to be recording this webinar and we'll be sending out a link to access it later on today. So just a quick introduction. My name is Adam Smith and I'm a sales and marketing associate with Discovery Garden. I joined the team in 2015 and have quickly become immersed in a broad range of Islandora projects. I may have dealt with many of you online here today, but for those of you who I haven't had the pleasure of meeting, I look forward to doing so in the near future. So for today's webinar, we're going to start with a quick overview of Islandora, which will lead into the introduction of our guest speakers, and then on to the presentation featuring the CUHK Digital Collections. Following that, I'll open the floor to any questions that you may have for Louise or Jeff regarding their Islandora project. And as your mics will be muted, I'll ask that you type your questions in the chat window, and I'll gladly read them out loud during the Q&A session. So with that, let's begin. So as I mentioned, let's start by talking a little bit about Islandora for anyone who is new to the community. The Islandora open source technology stack consists of three core components, being Drupal, Apache Solr, and Fedora Commons. The stack also includes a lot of utility components and dependencies as well. Islandora is a very large open source software stack that includes many applications. So in essence, the developers of Islandora and the community that supports it are experts at integrating third-party tools into Islandora. So now let's talk a little bit about the core components individually, and we'll start with Drupal. Many of you are familiar with Drupal, as it is a leading open source content management system with over 30,000 user contributed modules from almost 100,000 active community members or developers. Active community members are vital to any open source project, and the same can be said for Drupal. People are invested in Drupal, and that leads to ongoing development and success. Drupal serves as the presentation layer within Islandora. It's how we create a website and how we expose it to the internet. We also use Drupal for collaboration. It is a great framework for users, roles, and permissions. We use that for workflow activities, and it really does integrate in with a lot of other functionality within Islandora. So Islandora is a suite of Drupal modules that allows us to build on top of Fedora Commons. These modules make it possible to build, populate, and configure a digital repository without the aid of a developer. So next is Apache Solr. Apache Solr is used for discovery within Islandora. Solr is very powerful, very flexible, and very configurable. And it's used on some of the most heavily trafficked websites and applications worldwide. Key features of Solr include full text search, search faceting and filtering. It's highly scalable and fault tolerant, and it provides near real-time indexing. For example, if we ingest an object into Islandora, it's going to be indexed within Solr almost immediately and will become searchable probably within 30 seconds after the ingest. Final core component is Fedora Commons. Fedora is the layer that stores and preserves all of our digital content. Fedora Commons is purpose-built for data preservation and long-term data accessibility. Key features include auditing and fixity checks, RDF, XML support. We are able to scale Fedora Commons to millions of objects, and it has support for virtually any file type. It's built for interoperability as well. That means you can export or migrate your data in a format so that it can be stored elsewhere should you do so. So as mentioned, those three core components make up the open source technology framework. We like to call it a framework as it really is the integration of components working together. Now, organizations all over the world are using the Islandora framework to build their repositories. And some of these instances are customized in order to meet specific needs. And some are not customized as the software is very usable out of the box. People are scaling these repositories into the millions of objects, and they continue to have these large repositories perform very well. It helps to create fast, usable sites that are meeting all of our customers' expectations. So now let's move on to a very quick overview of how Discovery Garden fits into the picture. So Discovery Garden is a service provider of Islandora. We work to remove barriers using the open source technology. We launched in 2010, and we are a partner in the Islandora Foundation, which is a nonprofit entity that fosters the Islandora code. Since we've launched, we've contributed to over 90% of the Islandora code base, which we've written here at Discovery Garden on behalf of our many customers. We offer a lot of services that relate to an Islandora repository, and a complete list of our services can be found on our website. And I'll include that in a link in the information package that I'm going to send out later on today. So one of the biggest philosophies that we live by, and one that continues to be more and more recognized by organizations all around the world, is that in our view, it's worth it to invest in people and ideas instead of software licenses. We are very happy that our clients recognize that we are invested in the Islandora open source community, and we are working each day to enhance the product. Okay, so that being said, we'll move on to the reason that many of you are here today. It is my pleasure to introduce Louisa Lam, Head of Research Support and Digital Initiatives, and Jeff Liu, Digital Services Librarian at the CUHK Library. The CUHK Library has curated a collection of over 5 million digital objects in the past 20 years. It features Chinese literature, culture, arts, politics, society, and religion. Until recently, the collection was stored in a broad range of different systems, complicating the discovery of these precious digital assets. The new CUHK Islandora-based repository officially launched in February 2016, making the CUHK Library Digital Initiative pioneers in Hong Kong. So without further ado, I'll turn things over to Louisa and Jeff. Welcome.
Hi. Good morning. I'm Louisa. I was feeling very honored that I and Jeff are being invited today to introduce our repository to all of you. So before we start, I would like to introduce myself. As Adam just said, that I'm now working in the research support and digital initiatives. This is a new team that our library just set up last year in July 2005. So before that, I'm the head of information technology and planning, which is an IT team of the library. So I've had some experience in managing digitization projects before moving to this new team. So Jeff?
Hello everyone, I'm Jeff. I'm Digital Services Librarian from CHK Library since July last year, that's less than 1 year. Before that, I was a systems librarian, you know, with standard duties of system librarian like management of iOS, EasyPosty website, technical support of all e-resources and different application support. And most importantly, I was also responsible for digitization in my last position. Before that, you know, a standard system librarian might not have deep understanding or prior knowledge about metadata, mocks, solar, video commands. All of them are the core components of Islandora, but I'm still learning it. So let's get started. I will pass it back to Louisa.
Right. I think most of you that are not yet in Hong Kong would like to know about our university, so maybe I have a brief introduction to you all first. Our university was established in 1963. We are one of the 8 universities in Hong Kong that was subsidized by the government as a comprehensive research university. In terms of the physical size, our campus is the largest in Hong Kong. We have currently 9 colleges. We are a college system in our university. So we have 9 colleges, 8 faculties and graduate schools with more than 8,000 undergrads and thousands of teaching staff. Next slide, please. Adam, next slide, please. Right, thank you. So this is our library. Our libraries, previously was called the library system. Obviously, under our umbrella, there are several libraries. Besides the university library, we have 3 college libraries which is the Chongqing College Library, the New Asia College Library, and also United College Wuchang Multimedia Library. We also have three subject libraries, the Law Library, the Architecture Library, and lastly is the Liping Medical Library, which is away from our main campus in Sha Tin. So our library has hosts a very important special collection. And as Adam just said, we started the session in 1995. So you may all be interested to know why we moved into Islandora. Next slide, please, Adam. Next slide, please, Adam. Okay. So here is an overview of what we have in our digital collections. As you can see, there are a number of collections in this slide. These are all we have developed over the past 20 years. Of course, as we have over 5 million digital objects, not all of them are now migrated to the repository. But today, we're happy that we will highlight some of the interesting Chinese collections to you all. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Thank you. So currently, we have already ingested about 300,000 something objects into the system. One key features of our collections are that 98% of our collections are in books or manuscript format. And out of that, 11,000 are from our electronic thesis dissertation collections, ETD. So there are also images and photos. In terms of languages, 95% are in Chinese. So today, our presentation will focus mainly on our Chinese digital collection. We have a long way to go as we just soft launch our system and officially launch it in March. So we still have 3 million image objects that are not yet migrated, and we continue the development of our new collection. Some of you may be interested to know why we take a bold move to Islandora. So this slide will tell you something about our background, but I'll try to keep the story short. So before 2012, all our 5 million digital objects are seated on a very old system. We call them Tamino XML database. One key difficulty that we encountered in this system is that this database has no front end. So our team have to develop a new interface with a new design for every digital collection that we want to launch. Given that we have lots of our colleagues and also they have different views, so this takes a lot of time and also quite inflexible for us to cater so many different ideas from all sides. In addition, the metadata schema is very different for each project that we handle. So because every project sits on every single system, so it is not an easy way to handle metadata in this way. And also, although before we use Islandora, we are in the technical team, but because of the historical reasons and also some structural problem, our team still need to submit a request for change, even as minor as a type of change. We need to submit our request to the system team to get it updated. Again, this is not desirable for us because we cannot get our problem solved as quickly as we want. And we also found that most of our colleagues have been with us for many, many years in the library. They're already accustomed to the current way of handling digital objects. They are not open yet to many new platforms, especially open source development. So because of that, we found that we need to change. However, we also realized in around 2013 that it is really not easy or even a long road to take to implement a new permanent home for all our digital collections. So as an interim solution, we decided to develop a new portal. We call them University Digital Initiatives. UDI portal that use Drupal as the CMS. At least this provides a standard interface for all the digital collections that we have at that time. So starting from 2014, our team started to look for different solutions and alternative systems. And we also started to develop a feasible list of requirements. Some of the considerations that were thought of is that the system must have both a front end and a back end instead of the rather local and isolated development that we are currently having in the old system. And also we preferred a open source system instead of a proprietary system so that we are able to get the support from the open source community. So and another problem that we encountered at that time is we realized that the team structure is very important for our to realize our digital repository. But we are lucky that at this very critical moment, we asked for the review.
I'm sorry, I'm going to cut in for a second. I'll ask that everybody please mute your microphone so that we can reduce background noise while Louise is presenting. Thank you. Sorry, Louise, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. So we realized that the team culture is very important to have a quick development of our repository. At this particular critical moment, we're very lucky that we asked for the university librarian to develop a new department to take on digital initiatives. So we quickly took on this new mission and set up the new team that can take hold of the repository development to get ready for the move. So as you can see in this slide that this is an outline of our project timeline. So in summer 2014, I decided to send Jeff to explore different systems. I sent him to attend the Open Repository Conference 2014 held at Helsinki. And after returning from this conference, he got a lot of insights from different platform systems. And he finally identified Islandora that, first of all, it can satisfy our language requirement, which is to handle particularly Chinese characters. So we decided, among a number of systems that we tested at that time, we decided to select Islandora. At first, we started as our own team to experiment with the implementation and installation of Islandora.
Thank you so much.
But the experience at that time is that we need some vendor support like Discovery Garden to help us. In fact, having vendor support is also one of the major reasons why we select Islandora at that time. So in 2014 October, we started to contract with the Discovery Garden to start the so it started in 2014 with this October we contract with Discovery Garden. After that all our development can be moved faster than before. So Discovery Garden helped us with the installation, about the theming and also customization of the key features of our repository. Some of these key features have been presented in the Islandora conference 2015 that Jeff attended. But Jeff will also in a moment highlight some of these changes to you all. So our development started in July 2015 because at that time Jeff was released from a major after migrating from the library website, he was released to set up a new team and started to focus his attention on the repository development. But before that, we have a faculty request to ingest about 100 volume of a collection, we call them Taoist text collection, which is a Chinese rebel on Taoism into the system so that this faculty member can test the collection for his research. At that time, our team do not quite understand deeply about the architecture and also structure of Islandora. But this turned out to be a very good experience for us because although the ingestion, we have to ingest all of them later on, but this is a very real experience for us to test on the user experience and also for our team to learn how to handle ingestion, how to test a system, how to make a system work for us. So after setting up the new team, we spearheaded the development of the repository. The new team consisted of just Jeff as a digital services librarian and one web programmer, which has had some experience in Drupal development as he was involved in our library website. So, so both of our team members can dedicate their time and attention to development of the repository. Starting from 2015, as you can see in this slide, that we studied and also implemented the metadata standards. Just to explain a little more about that, about our metadata, how it posed challenge to us. So after massaging the metadata, at that time we tried to develop some small programs so that we can export the metadata and convert them into the MOX format that Islandora can take in. We also developed ingestion workflow after a series of trial and error. So real ingestion of Chinese Rebel started in around mid-October. So our team working hard performance. And so the repository was able to be soft launched around February in 2016, and also officially open to the world on March 17, together with our digital scholarship lab. We also explained a little bit about how the lab relates to this project. And so now we'll continue with our migration. Now I would like to pass the time to Jeff to introduce some interesting collections in our repository before and after having Islandora. Jeff, please.
Okay, thank you, Louisa. The first collection I would like to highlight is our Chinese Web of Digital Collection. Before moving into Islandora, it was housed in a portal that Louisa mentioned in a Drupal CMS. It used the exposed filter in Drupal view for searching and browsing. The ebooks available are all in flash format, as you can see in the at the right hand side of the images. And they are all housed in a different server that is independent to the Drupal CMS. We know it is not desirable, as it is quite difficult to handle the content updates. And also the flash player is retiring, so we have to find our way out. Next slide, please. With the new Islandora, we can easily use the Internet Archive Book Solution Pack to ingest and display the Chinese Web collection on a single platform. The upload and data updates is really good, are all handled by us, by ourselves. This greatly improves the efficiency. And also, to cater for our special needs for displaying Chinese character metadata, we have made some localized changes for the metadata conversion from our library catalog that was based in Innovative ILS to the MOX XML metadata file, including flipping of MarkTag880 with MarkTag245. Because in our cataloging standard, MarkTag245 is used for holding pinyin. Pinyin is the standard system of romanized Chinese. Maybe you all not familiar with. And MarkTag880 is, according to Library of Congress, is for holding alternate graphic representation. That is storing our Chinese characters. As there's a need for us for displaying Chinese characters as the image of the label in Fedora or in Islandora, we inverted both tags during the transformation from MARC to MOX. Next slide, please. Yes, thank you. Another customization is the page progression direction. The flipping direction for all Chinese books and English is different. So we sought help from Discovery Garden, and they help us to develop and implement a perfect solution for this. You may refer to our presentation earlier in the Islandora Conference in August 2015. Next slide, please. Another problem we encounter is that Chinese web books usually are in series format. That means one single title has hundreds of volumes. For example, we have uploaded one with under the same title, then it has over 200 volumes of books. So there's a need to display volume number in the correct order for each title. Previous slide. Yes, thank you. At the beginning, we have considered using Islandora's compound. Adam, can you go back to the previous slide? At the beginning of project, we have considered using a compound object solution pack to display such relationship. But the display of all form layers of the series is not quite satisfactory and it is not so fast. So we have tried using the part number or mock to form the object label so as to distinguish the series of books under the same title. However, we run into another problem because if we use the Islandora default sorting, volume 2 is shown after volume 19, volume 199, or whatever that starts with volume 1 something. So at last, we test and confirmed to use both the title info and numeric value of the part number from the MOS XML for a proper sorting. And we are not sure if we are not the only case for this, but our users are now very satisfied for the display and sorting. Next slide, please. Our repository is also part of the initiative of our new team. So it is about the construction of a digital scholarship lab that was opened on the same day that the repository was officially launched in March. With Islandora, we are able to ingest high resolution images and also use the OpenSea Dragon Viewer to display these images perfectly in the very huge display wall at the lab. You can see that, you can see the display wall in the diagram here. It is built from 12 number of 55 inch TVs so as to provide over 24 million of pixels. Our users love to play with this kind of images very much in the lab and using our Islandora at the same time. Next slide, please. With the success of DAOist test, there is the rare books in Daoism. We continue with the ingestion of other Chinese rare book collection. The next one to come is about Chinese medicine collection. So up to now, we have ingested over 320,000 page objects from over 1,800 rare books into the repository. And we will continue the migration day and night, but this may take more than a year to complete. Next slide, please. The next collection we would like to highlight is the electronic thesis and dissertations one. This is one of our major collections in terms of size and usage. This collection was launched in 2014 with over 10,000 records. Again, it was also built on the same terminal XML database. We used iframe to embed the search and browse pages. You know, it is really not professional, but we have no choice at that time. The full text PDFs, again, are hosted at another server that we could not access for upload and managing. So similar to the uploading of the other collections, we need to request our technician to update record. Moreover, owing to the limitations of the system, the default search does not support full text by default. And also there's no OAIP image function for harvesting by other system. So it changes after we have Islandora. Because of the significance of this collection, we decide to migrate it into Islandora. The metadata, as in those Chinese web books, are so well structured that we simply extract from library catalog. The migration is super smooth and fast. It took us less than 3 days to migrate all the 10,000 records. It's really much faster than what we have expected. But in this collection, we have also encountered some difficulties because the challenge is the display of using the display of Chinese characters in the Islandora solar facet module. As you can see in the diagram on the right hand side, we have added a Chinese link or Chinese prefix, for example, for this. But this is not default supported by the modules or supported by the solar. So we have some customization. Our programmer has made some customization to differentiate Chinese records and group them under the new Chinese map tag, as shown in the diagram. We hope this can facilitate the using of this collection. So I will pass back to Louisa to introduce two more collections. Next slide, please.
Thanks, Jeff, for introducing in details about our two collections. Another one is the image collection, which is small, but very important one is about oracle bones. These oracle bones were donated to one of our college libraries in 1969, so many, many years ago. And the images were taken at around year 2000. So the images, in fact, the quality of images are not so good at that time. So before we migrated this collection to Islandora, we can only use a HTML web page to display the images and use the Drupal view to store and display in our portal. This is not so good, and the metadata was not yet handled at that time. Luckily, after the repository was launched, an expert from Taiwan Academic Syndicate was invited to our university. He worked on the collection, and he was able to provide a new set of proper metadata for this collection. So this collection is the first one that all the metadata are come from ArchivesSpace, which is a archival management system. So apart from the library catalog, this is another challenge that we have to take on, because this archival software have a different metadata structure and also level of details than the library catalog. But luckily, we are able to develop a workflow to handle the metadata from ArchivesSpace. And we also use the Google OpenRefine to massage the metadata to follow the mock schema for Islandora. So after moving this collection to Islandora with the proper metadata from ArchivesSpace, we are now able to use OpenC Dragon Viewer to display and also enlarge the images clearly for our user. This is especially useful when we view the images at our lab. Another development is that our library is now experimenting with 3D scanning and printing. So hopefully we want to explore further whether Islandora is able to display 3D images, especially with this oracle bones collection. Next slide, please. So this is the fourth collection we want to introduce today. But this is not yet built in our system. This is a new one on the pipeline, but it is very interesting because this is a collaboration project with the Art Museum in CUHK. It is about the letters and manuscript of Mr. Feng Xunwei, who was a very influential merchant in the Qing Dynasty. So Art Museum get hold of his letters and manuscripts that describe the political situation in China at that time. And also they invited a Shanghai expert to transcribe all the letters and manuscripts into text file. So at that time, our team thought how to display these two pieces of information clearly to our user to enhance the using of our collection. So at that time, again, we invited the Soviet government to help us to display the images together with the transcribed text in the vertical direction that was the standard writing direction for Chinese text at that time. So now, as you can see in the slide, on the right-hand side is the transcribed text in vertical direction from top to the bottom. And on the left-hand side is the image of the manuscript that correspond to that text. So users is able to view the images together with transcribed text side by side. We hope that this will enable our users to explore the collection better. This collection will be launched at around 2016, hopefully. In addition, this also correlates to how we handle Chinese characters as a whole in our repository. So we try to keep this short because we have explained this in the Islandora conference. So Chinese characters, we have the traditional format, which is more complicated, with simplified format, and also variant Chinese characters. In Hong Kong, we're trying to handle these kind of, we call them mapping and also cross-searching using a table called TSECC table. As we're given here, the slide about the word Taiwan, consists of two Chinese characters. You can see that they have different unique code in our system. So how we handle this requires some text. So we asked Discovery Garden to implement our TSECC mapping table into Solr. Now the browsing and searching is getting resolved in our repository, and our development team is now conducting more tests to enhance a more precise search about the word, single word search and the phrase search of Chinese characters. So this is what we want to share with you all about our collections, how our journey towards Islandora. So throughout these 2 years experience, our whole team thought that there are some lessons that we can share with you all. First is that we found that the learning curve of Islandora is really very steep. At that time, we did not anticipate that it would take us such a time to develop the system and also migrate our collection. But we all learned a lot during our experience working with Discovery Garden, the self-learning process, and also attendance at different conferences. We also appreciate the support from the Islandora community, which is very, very supportive, and we rely on actually, a lot of our technical problems, we post it into the community to get the feedback. And also, a real challenge to us is about the migration of metadata. Our metadata sources come from the library catalog and also archive space, with a different set of data structure and also different level of details. How we're able to develop a standardized and automatic workflow to migrate them and display them clearly in the repository, to let the users explore the repository better is a real challenge, and we took quite a long time to develop the programs and workflow for it. So I'm lucky that our team is very dedicated to this development. And lastly, we're able to, with Islandora, we're able to develop a single workflow for different types of media that we ingested into the system. And finally, we thought that handling a system development in this scale and migrating so many objects into the system requires our team's much dedication, focus, and concentration. So the development of a new team that so that they can really pay their attention and also resources to the repository development is really a great help during this migration. I think I hope that this we also have other colleagues that are planning migrating to Islandora will be a great take home message that dedication is really important. And also, as we said, that this initiative is our core mission in our new team. And we're lucky that repository is able to work with our digital scholarship initiative to accomplish some of our mission. And in future, we'll explore further whether Islandora can develop some, can handle some digital scholarship projects. So this is what we want to share with you all quite long. So I hope you won't be bored. So here is our contact information. I hope that you can put your question up and so that we can answer it.
Okay, thank you, Louisa and Jeff, very much for that informative discussion. The team here at Discover Garden are certainly very proud of being part of such a magnificent project, and we're happy that it's been so successful on your end as well. So with that, I'd like to open the floor to questions. As mentioned at the beginning of the call, if you would please type your questions in the chat window, I'll gladly read them out loud. Again, this will allow people to leave their mics muted and cut down on background noise.
Okay.
So I'll start things off here, Louisa and Jeff. You mentioned that this project had a steep learning curve. What subjects or topics proved to be the most difficult to you?
Maybe Jeff can share his view.
Okay. Yes, I think the most deep part is the startup part, because we have encountered a lot of difficulties and problems when we start to install the system by our own team, and then start some minor customizations of it. Before that, we have some experience using Drupal, but Islandora is really far away, really different from a standard Drupal. It's more advanced and a mature system. So we start learning it, and we have maybe because we are not focused, and maybe because of Islandora is too difficult. So we are not moving very fast at the beginning, but after we have concentrated, and after we have attended the Islandora conference, we have learned a lot from it, and then the whole project is moving fast.
Good. Sorry, Louisa, we're having some trouble hearing you.
Okay. Although I'm not doing all the technical parts, I oversee the whole project development. I thought that because all our collections are in Chinese, so and also we need to, the faculty also, because most of our projects are a collaboration project with our faculties, they have quite a different set of requirements than we anticipate at first. For example, display the volume together, volume number together with the title causes a lot of, even as simple as that, causes some time to figure out. We try different ways, and we ask a lot of questions, posted to the discovery garden, and there are some even small bugs will make a display quite a different behavior than we expect. So this explains why there are every day seems that the new things we learn from Andorra. So our new team thought that the learning curve is really deep for us.
Okay. And just a follow up to that, you mentioned one objective of the project was to enhance discoverability. Have you seen an increase in users accessing the repository since it's launched, or is it too soon to tell?
We have also installed the the module used to capture the usage statistics for Andorra, and we have also installed Google Scholar to record the statistics of access. So right now, I think that the access rate is satisfactory and is improving because of we are also holding another exhibition about Taoism in the library. So at that exhibition a TV and an interactive TV is used to display our books so that people may be interested to more and then use more about our collections. So I think we have tried some ways to promote our collection so that the usage statistic is, I think, is not bad. And maybe after migration of our electronic thesis and dissertation collections, the collection will be improved a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Good, thank you. Well, if there's no more questions, again, I want to say thank you to everybody for joining us today. And I want to, in particular, thank Jeff and Louisa for their detailed description of the Islandora project. And it's, as I said earlier, we're very happy that it's been very successful on both ends. So on behalf of myself, Adam Smith, and everybody else here at Discovery Garden, I would like to thank you for attending today's webinar and wish everybody a great day. Goodbye.
I also like to thank Adam for inviting us to present our repository and our collection to you all, and also Aaron and all the
folks
from Discovery Garden.
Thank you.
Thank you again.
Okay, bye.
Bye-bye.